A major announcement about life on Earth was made last week by NASA and four ASU scientists. Researchers found a microbe that uses arsenic as a basic building block of life, something that would separate the organism from any other form of life as we know it. I'll talk to two of the researchers about their findings, but first, here's an excerpt from a NASA press briefing that features the ASU scientist who led the project.
All life that we know of requires carbon, hydrogen, nitrogen, oxygen, phosphorus, and sulfur. And it uses those six elements in some of the critical pieces I think we're all familiar with, including DNA and RNA, or the information technology of the cell, the proteins, which are the molecular machines, and the lipids, which separates you from everything else. And so by discovering, we've discovered an organism that can substitute one element for another in these major biomolecules. I'd like to introduce to you today the bacterium GFAJ-1. These are not little potatoes. They are a microbe that scientists lovingly call little bugs, but they're not bugs, they're microbes. And this is a bacterium that, although looks ordinary, and this may look like a type of micrograph many of us may have seen in different places, but it's doing something extraordinary. And so we'll talk about that. But first, let's find out where this microbe is from. Here we're looking at a map of Mono Lake, California. It's in Northern California and east of the Sierras, just outside of Yosemite National Park. Mono Lake is 3 times the salt of seawater, a pH of 10. It's basic, like bleach. And it's got very high levels of arsenic. And it's teeming with life. So the seemingly inhospitable environment teems with life, like bacteria and algae and brine shrimp, and is a major stopping point for migratory birds. I went to an environment to look for this particular microbe, and what we did, we took the muds of Mono Lake that we just were introduced to, and we wanted to see if anything would grow if we took that mud and we gave it in a laboratory environment that was rich in everything else it needed, sugar, vitamins, not that bad for us. And we added no phosphorus and added very high doses of arsenic. It was a double whammy, you could think of it. This is not an experiment that most people might run. But it was driven by my question, is there a microbe on Earth that could substitute arsenic for phosphorus in its basic biomolecular constituents? And so what did we find? We found that not only did this microbe cope or deal with the toxicity, we might say, with arsenic, but it grew and it thrived. And that was amazing. Nothing should have grown. Put your plant in the dark. It doesn't grow. So something grew. But now we wanted to find out what was happening. So we measured the insides of the cells. We took the cells and we measured the total arsenic concentration inside the cells. It was taking up this arsenic. That's unusual. And then we found that the arsenic was associated specifically with a band of genomic DNA. So here we're seeing the beautiful, elegant structure of the double helix of DNA. And what I want to highlight is the phosphate backbone, we say, and that's the light orange balls. And it stitches together as we see the edges of DNA. It holds together the DNA, the backbone. And so what we think is happening, what all the evidence we've collected suggests, is that instead of these, we'll see these orange, light orange balls disappear. And represented by green balls, we see that arsenic would be substituting for phosphorus in the backbone of DNA. And you can see how critical this component of the DNA might be. So what I've presented to you today is a microbe doing something different than life as we knew it. All life on Earth required carbon, nitrogen, oxygen, hydrogen, phosphorus, and sulfur. So I've shown here today that we've discovered a microbe that can substitute arsenic for phosphorus in its major biomolecules. And if there's an organism on Earth doing something different, we've cracked open the door to what's possible for life elsewhere in the universe. And that's profound.
And here now to discuss the discovery of the arsenic-based bacteria are ASU professors Paul Davies and Ariel Anbar. They're co-authors of the paper on the findings. Good to have you both here. And Paul, I want to start with you with a quick correction now. Mm-hmm. She was at ASU, but a lot of this work, most of this work, was done elsewhere. Talk to us about that.
Yeah, well, when I came to ASU 4 years ago, she was a young postdoc working with Ariel, and we began, the three of us, to develop the ideas for this arsenic life. Then she went to the U.S. Geological Survey in Menlo Park to work there on actually going out into the field and looking for it. And in this case, the field is Mono Lake.
Yes. Okay. Ariel, let's get to in more layman's terms here, because that was a pretty good description, I think, for a lot of scientists out there, but some folks are scratching their heads right now. What's she talking about?
Right.
What's she talking about?
What she's talking about is finding a microorganism that is able to substitute arsenic for phosphorus. These are two chemical elements. Phosphorus is in common fertilizer. People are somewhat familiar with phosphorus. Arsenic is a poison, you know that, right? So arsenic and phosphorus, as it turns out, are chemically rather similar to each other. In fact, the reason that arsenic is toxic, that it's poisonous, is because it gets into your body and mimics phosphorus up to a point, and then gums up the machinery and causes problems. So what she found is a microbe that's able to actually replace phosphorus with arsenic in its biomolecules. That's what the evidence strongly suggests.
Fully replace or adapt? What are we talking about here?
Well, at the moment, we don't know the detailed answers, how much of the phosphorus has been replaced, but clearly some of it has.
Correct.
And it's important to realize that when these things are pulled out of the lake, they're not, the replacement hasn't happened. They have dual capability. They like phosphorus and they like arsenic as well, and they'll sort of go with whatever you give them.
So again, this was mostly done, pull it out of the lake, and then you go ahead and do laboratory testing.
Right, and that lab's at the U.S. Geological Survey, where she's been culturing these organisms for the best part of a year and carefully experimenting with them. It's been a lot of painstaking work involving a lot of people.
And it's worth stressing that she's working in the lab of Ron Ormland at the USGS, who specialized in looking at how microorganisms can tolerate arsenic. There's a whole host of ways that they do that. What's unique here is this structural substitution, this replacing phosphorus, which is an essential molecule in the structure. It's a building block of biology, replacing phosphorus with arsenic. That's a very novel thing.
Was it there all along? Did it evolve? Do we know?
I think at this point the jury's still out. We don't really know. It certainly has this ability in the lab. We don't know for sure if it's doing it in nature, but it's logical that it would be doing it in nature. The reason that Felisa went to this lake is because it's rich in arsenic. It was a logical place to hunt for such an organism. But in terms of the history, all bets are off. It's still a very new story.
So we've got this microbe. It is, and arsenic, obviously, bad for us.
Right, good for it. I don't recommend it.
Yeah. Good for it, though, the microbe. Do we know if phosphorus toxic to the microbe in the same way arsenic
not
is?
Not this one. This one has dual capabilities. But if we follow the arsenic, maybe go to places where there's even more arsenic, we might find organisms that are thoroughly arsenic through and through right from the start, for which phosphorus will be a poison.
But that's speculation, just to be absolutely sure.
This one can work with both.
And in fact, it prefers phosphorus.
It grows better with phosphorus, but it can
grow on arsenic, is what the laboratory experiments indicate.
Okay, we've got the phosphorus, we've got the arsenic, we've got all that figured out, I think.
Okay.
Now, what does this all say about life on Earth? Life as we know it.
Well, if this holds up, what it says is that the building blocks of life are a little more flexible than we thought. There are six major elements that are particularly important in biology: carbon, hydrogen, oxygen, nitrogen, sulfur, and phosphorus. And that's canonical, those elements. And here what we find is it appears that here's an organism that can replace one of those building blocks, at least in part, with a toxic element. That's a big deal in biology if that holds up.
Replace in part, replace in full? How much do we replace?
Well, we don't know at this stage, but I think there's another lesson that comes out of this, which is that remarkable organisms can be hiding in plain sight right under our noses. There's nothing that distinguishes this particular bug from anything else. In fact, if Felisa hadn't done these experiments, nobody probably would have ever noticed it had remarkable arsenic capabilities. So when you look at its genome, it doesn't look like anything very exceptional. And so I think that the real point is that you can't tell by looking what makes a microbe tick. So there's the potential for all sorts of other surprises to be in store for us out there. And I'm sure people are going to be looking for other remarkable organisms.
Well, could one of those surprises, and in reading on this, I saw this more than once, the possibility of a shadow biosphere. First of all, what would a shadow biosphere, what does that mean?
Well, it's an idea actually that Paul has been very articulate in advancing. And it's the idea that there could be, hypothetically, and this is just a small step in that direction, if at all. But the idea that you could have a biosphere out there, organisms that we maybe see and even recognize, but don't realize that they're doing a very different biochemistry, very different metabolism. Paul likes to say,
yeah.
Well, go ahead.
Well, I'll tell you the background on this,
please,
how
please.
I got into it, because Ariel and I and Felisa work in a field called astrobiology. We're interested in whether there's life elsewhere in the universe. When I was a lad, nobody really believed there was anything beyond Earth, and now it's very fashionable to say, oh, the universe is teeming with life. There's lots of Earth-like planets, and most of them will have life on it. But we don't know. And one way of testing that is no planet is more Earth-like than Earth itself. So if life does pop up readily in Earth-like conditions, maybe it happened many times here on Earth. Maybe there isn't just one form of life. Maybe there's more than one. Now, the question is, how do we go find this so-called shadow biosphere, or life 2.0, if you like, this other form of life that might look the same at the microbial level, look the same, but is very different biochemically? It's a tough proposition, but we have a strategy for going to look for such a thing. Now, this is not it. This particular microbe is not the shadow biosphere, and for a simple reason, that when you sequence its genome, it can be positioned on the same tree of life as you and me.
Okay, so okay. So it is part of it. It's not completely alien.
Though. Right, no, it's not completely alien. But I make the point, I made earlier, that you can't tell by looking. And so maybe out there in Mono Lake or somewhere else could be microorganisms that really are alien, really do belong to not just a new branch on the tree of life, which this represents, but a new tree entirely.
Is that a capital M on that maybe, or a small M? What do you think?
My personal opinion is a capital M, but it's a very intriguing idea, and it motivates good research. This project wouldn't have happened if not for that idea.
So I'm a dreamer. So.
I think you know, science often, there's always this tension between evidence and rigor and bold ideas, and how do you balance that? And I think it takes all sorts of ideas to push the field forward.
So correct me if I'm wrong here, but the implication here is that it is possible that life could have evolved from, a 2.0, a different set of answers. Is that what, am I getting close there? Is that what
the
we're talking
second
about?
Second genesis.
That's Paul's suggestion. Yeah. And this relates to the search for life beyond Earth, obviously.
Exactly. Right?
Where this comes from is saying if the universe is teeming with life, if there's many organisms out there, that means it's not that hard for life to originate, and so hence you go down this path that Paul has suggested.
And if you found two forms of life right here on Earth, then it would be inconceivable that all those other Earth-like planets that are shortly out there are going to have no life. You know, twice on one planet and none on the rest. It just doesn't seem right.
But this is not that. Just to get to pull this back a little bit.
Okay.
This makes it a bit more likely. I mean, the size of that capital M is a little bit smaller now than it was maybe, you know, a week ago.
But also it'll encourage people to look.
Absolutely.
Sure. And speaking of encouraging people to look, have we been looking in the wrong places in the wrong ways for life on other planets, extraterrestrial life? What does this do to that whole situation?
Well, so I direct the astrobiology program at ASU and the School of Earth and Space Exploration and several other units there. And the theme of our program, and this project fits right into it, is follow the elements. So NASA's had this idea of following the water to look for life, and there's lots of water out there, it turns out. So water alone is not a good enough guide to tell you where to go. You only get one shot at Mars every so often, right? So if there's 20 places to go, how do you choose? And so the philosophy is, well, let's think about what life needs to survive. And after water, you need the right chemical elements, these six building blocks that I mentioned before. So our philosophy has been, well, let's think about where those are abundant and where those aren't, and use that as a guide. But now what Felisa's study suggests is we need to think harder about what elements we want to follow. So it's going to shape the search in that way. It's going to get us a bit outside the box that we've been.
Is this also going to get outside the box and change the way microbiology is taught, is learned, is thought about?
In some respects. It depends how far this goes.
Yes. I think when you find something really weird in science, there are always two possibilities. One is it's just a quirky little incidental embellishment on our body of knowledge, and the other is it really strikes at the heart of something fundamental. It's too soon to say whether this is just a, you know, funny little thing in Mono Lake, or whether it really shows that we have to rethink the whole microbiology of the planet. It'd be exciting if it's the latter, but
yeah,
I'm the dreamer.
That's right.
He's the skeptic. Science needs both.
Well, we got the dreamer, we got the skeptic, we got the media right here, and the media's gone nuts with this. Are you surprised at the response to this thing so far? I mean, people, Washington Post, New York, everyone is talking about ASU and space exploration and maybe a new form of life on Earth. Surprise you a little bit?
Well, no. I've been through a number of these sort of media flaps over the years about science stories, and I've seen them come and go. And we're all pleased, of course, at the huge amount of interest. So maybe I'm not too surprised.
What about the response? What have you seen from the response so far? Has any of it surprised you?
I don't know that I've been surprised. I was a little dismayed by some of the rumors that started to build up. As you know, NASA announced that we're going to have a press conference, and in the days between then and the actual press conference, people's imaginations really ran away with them. There was going to be life on Titan announced and things like that. Very creative ideas. Be great if they were true, but not. That wasn't the case.
Yeah, so people got a little overboard, and then we had to reel them back in a little bit.
Right.
Well, let's go overboard again here, just for the last few minutes. Could this be dangerous? Are we talking an Andromeda strain?
No. Because you see, this is an organism that has evolved here on Earth, and as I said earlier, it's on the same tree of life as you and me. And of course, it's been sitting in Mono Lake without anybody having any ill effects. But it could have therapeutic value, and this is the interesting angle. It could be the exact opposite of dangerous, because groundwater contamination with arsenic is a real problem in poor countries. And one way of tackling any contamination is bioremediation, using microorganisms to clean up. And so there's potential there. And the other is in cancer research. Arsenic is known to be a cancer risk, but also a possible cancer therapy. And so I'm looking forward to studying the cancer implications of this new organism.
Well, very good. We'll end on that optimistic note. Gentlemen, thank you so much for joining us. We appreciate it.
Thank you.
Thank you.